What's up, all y'all trickly bastards, and welcome back to It's 1700 Somewhere. As always, I am Athan.
I'm Cameron Bates, and I'm the new co-host.
He is the new co-host. So, I'm going to go in and start checking comments and stuff like that here on the computer, and I'll talk a little bit while we're doing that. So, yeah, as y'all know, I had a couple of weeks. What's up, bud? There we go, it's working. All right, so I took a couple weeks off without saying too much. Some things went south in my life real quick, and that's interesting. Some things went south in my life real quick, and Desiree and I are separated. She will no longer be on the show, and we've got Cameron here to fill in. We're making some changes to the show and stuff like that. We also sometimes Josh will be here. He wasn't able to make it today, so. Anyways, introduce yourself and tell a little bit about yourself there, Cameron.
So, name's Cameron Bates, born and raised in Houston, Texas, was in the Navy from September 11, 2011 to September 2015. I was stationed on the USS Wyoming, blue and gold. I was also stationed on the USS Alaska Gold. I did six patrols in my time in the Navy. I was a machinist mate, wound up getting out on honorable terms, and started looking around, finding new vets to hang out with, came across Athan, and became good buddies pretty quickly, and you know, getting back into that camaraderie is a great sensation.
Awesome. So, and I'm gonna go ahead and remove this share screen, so, or this desktop region. Boop. All right, because we don't need that there. You don't have any video or anything right now. We'll set that up after you
get no, hopefully next, yeah, hopefully next week I will have an actual camera, which means I'll unfortunately have to clean my room a little bit.
Always have to clean. Cleaning is the horrible part of things. All right, let's get that set there. So sorry, I'm all washed out. I have a fucking window behind me. So, all right. So we got a lot of stories for you this week.
Yeah, that we do. A lot of game stories as well. So if you're a hardcore gamer, this might be the episode for you.
So, yes. So we got a few people I want to give shout out to watching. We got Kateri Silvera. She's from FemVets, also here on Vet Radio Syndicate. And we got Annie Marie Honeycutt, who has been an amazing help to me throughout these last couple weeks. She's been there to talk to me if I need them. Hi, Annie. So, yes. Thank you, everyone, for all that. So let's go ahead and move right along forward in some stories. So did you want to start with something there, Cameron, or you want me to?
Yeah, sure. I'll kick it off. Last week, Mountain Blade 2 is a multiplayer beta. They have released last week the ability to start playing the beta to a limited amount of people. Unfortunately, you are not allowed to play the actual story mode right now. They're testing out the new matchmaking systems to see how it is going to affect players. There's no given release date yet, and it is being kept small to directly test and give accurate feedback, while all the while trying to stabilize the system for its actual release. The announcement, however, was 7 years ago, and just now they are calling the release for the first steps.
So at Mountain Blade 2, that's been in development for like 7 years now, so I know I've been wanting to check it out for a long time. I signed up for beta, but I didn't get accepted into beta for it. But it's basically like a first-person melee combat type game. It looks awesome. Real awesome. So maybe when it gets released finally at some point.
Yeah. So. Unfortunately, with no release date, we're still waiting. Yeah. 7 years is a long time to wait for some games. However, a lot of the Game of Thrones fans out there that know that sometimes waiting can be good or bad.
Yeah, exactly. If they spend too much time, send things in the wrong direction. And it's a closed beta, too. So, like, that means they're still quite a ways off from actually dropping it and all that. So,
shame, shame.
Yep. So, but at least they're out of alpha.
Yeah. Taking some steps.
Yeah. So that was the Mountain Blade. Do we want to? Are we? Do we have things that we're going in like a certain order? Do we plan that out or whatnot?
No, not necessarily. However, the next article that you had given me to go over was the Steam sale currently going on right now for games that are under $10.
Okay.
I don't know a lot of them. I've played a few of them, so I'm going to cover the ones that I particularly like and some of the ones that, well, we know there's fan service in there for a reason, like Bayonetta, which is currently at $5. But my personal favorites are probably going to be Dead by Daylight. I'm a huge horror fan. I love the thrill. I love the scare. Unfortunately, a lot of people that play those kind of games think they're safest in the light. And it is very funny to find out that if you stay in the light too long, somebody else is going to find you. Another one that my personal favorite right now is Rainbow Six Siege. It's $10 exactly. It's a tactical shooter with traps, barbed wire explosions, snipers, multiple maps to go over, and constantly getting updated in new changes. They just brought back claymores. They brought back the deployable shields. They're bringing back new old characters that they had taken out for a while. But that shows you that that company keeps up with what they need to do to keep the game entertaining and alive. It's very good to see a company that stays active with it within its own games. Another one that you, me, and a couple of the other guys have been playing a lot right now have been Rocket League, which is a basically you're a car playing soccer. That's the easiest way to explain it. You have to maintain your boost all the while dealing with whatever kind of map the map you're on, which you could have Rumble, you could have, you know, they're doing a spike challenge right now, which is ridiculously easy if you know how to play it, because you just run around with spikes and pick up a ball and go. There's a lot of people out there that are very impressive to play against, though. Watching them be able to do some air tricks and get those flying shots in
Oh,
is
dude.
very entertaining.
Some of those dudes jumping off the wall and shit, flying across the map.
I
Yo.
do not have that capability.
No, I do not either. I'm trying to.
For those that love co-op games, guess what? Portal 2 is now on sale for 99 cents. Just remember, the cake is always a lie.
The
I
cake.
was not The cake is always a lie.
I've never
My
played
brother,
Portal.
it is a puzzle game where you create portals and try and bounce around. I got like halfway in and my attention span split off and my eyes started to go cross-eyed. I couldn't keep up with it. I don't have the attention span for that. But if you like puzzle games, that's one you're gonna love. It's constant puzzles. Never listen to the robot. The cake is a lie.
So, did you mention Rainbow Six Siege?
I did.
You did? Okay. I was sharing some groups, so I didn't hear everything. I know a couple of the games that are in the list I've heard of, and was kind of interested in, like, where is it at? Skylines, City Skylines. I have actually played that one. That one's like you said, you didn't like it very much because it doesn't have
Not
a tutorial.
particular. I enjoyed playing Civilization 5 and 6 much more, or Age of Empires, but without the tutorial, jumping straight into City Skylines, it was difficult to try and grasp what you needed to do, what the challenges were. There wasn't a whole lot of give and take to tell you about what's going on. So I couldn't get into it because of the early gameplay. But if you can get past that, I've got a couple other friends that play it and they claim they love it. So.
Like I said, I like it. I don't play it a lot, but I like it. I was always a fan of like SimCity, all that stuff too. So, but I don't have all the expansion packs, and they're actually pretty expensive for it. And the game's a lot better when you have the expansion packs. So, and then
Yeah, fully agree.
another one that I saw that I liked that I've been wanting to play was Dirt Rally. That's a racing game. So, you know, it's got a lot of off track, you know, rally racing, dirt racing, and all that stuff. So that's
It
one
was
I've
very interesting to read the comments on that game as well, because there a lot of the people are claiming that it's got a more realistic feel. The gravel, you know, different kind of treads under your tires will affect you so much more. So if you're drifting or if you're taking a turn too hard and you hit a different patch of material, your car is going to react essentially the same it would in real life, which is very impressive to hear from a company. Because I know all the old racing games I played, I mean, you basically do whatever you want.
They're all pretty much just like driving. Like, I don't know, like, I used to like the Gran Turismo games, but I got out of even those. So it's like
Yeah, I think a lot of people did.
I haven't been playing a lot of racing games lately. So, and then Rainbow Six Siege, of course, we've been playing a lot of that. Dragon's Dogma. Dragon's Dogma has always been a pretty good game. I've heard a lot of good news on that one.
Originally released in 2012, now this RPG is picking up momentum and apparently rather quickly it's becoming more and more popular.
Yep. So, and it's always been a pretty good game. I've never actually played it, but I've heard lots of good things about it. So,
And for $9, I mean,
exactly.
that's not a bad deal.
Yep. And then Firewatch is another one that's on that list, and that's at $4.99. That's more of just kind of a strategy game. So basically, the game takes place in the 80s. You're a park ranger, and you're in your tower, and you're watching out, and there's a fire that starts, and you have to go out and investigate things and figure out why the fire started. It's not a combat-oriented game from anything that I've seen of it. It's mostly just basically a puzzle game. But it looked like a really good game if you're into that kind of stuff. I'm not so much into that low key of a game, but it did look like it was a pretty good game when I was seeing about it. And those are all the games that I liked out of that list myself.
And the remarks on Firewatch were also very, very positive about the storyline. They were very happy with how well it flowed. It wasn't sporadic. It wasn't one that, oh, hey, you need to jump over here, go do this, go do this. It had a smooth transition through the whole part.
So there's that stuff. We can get into a little bit more of our new stuff. Because that's one of our next stories we have up. I don't know if how many of you out there. I'm one of these people, but if you take any of the proton pump inhibitor type medicines, so we're talking like any of the Tagamet, Pepcid, those kinds of things, and then what's the one I take? I think it's omeprazole. Those have been linked to heart disease, like deadly heart disease, and other types of stomach cancer and stuff like that, kidney disease. So if you take those, just be aware of that. The more you take them, the longer you take them, the higher your risk of these diseases are. I've been taking that stuff for quite a long while, and I used to take a lot of the Tagamet and Pepcid. Like I was at a point taking three of them at a time because my heartburn was so bad. So I'm trying to cut back on even my omeprazole at this point. I've been only taking it every other day now instead of every day. So just wanted to give everyone a heads up on that. Check out for your health, watch your health, and all that stuff.
And some of the statistics for that are absolutely horrifying. Let me give you some of them. 4 in 1,000 people suffer from a kidney disease. 2 in 1,000 people suffer from stomach cancer. More than 15 million Americans have been prescribed, and millions more are taking these over the counter. And the research has showed a 17% increased risk of death. 15 in 1,000 alone died from heart issues from taking these medicines.
It's like me, I've been getting told that I'm having problems, possibly with my heart. So, I've got high blood pressure and all that other stuff, and they're wanting me to get on a heart healthy diet, Mediterranean of sorts. So
Let's not forget, Big Pharma doesn't create patients, they create lifelong users. I mean, look at some of the side effects for any other medication. Look at antidepressants. Possible side effects could include anal leakage, could include thoughts of suicide. I mean, some of the medicines you take nowadays are absolutely terrible for
Yeah,
you.
I know a medicine they give you for because you have depression and all that stuff and thoughts of suicide could in fact actually cause more thoughts of suicide, which that's bass ackwards and as far as I'm concerned. I don't get that. But hey.
And there's always an interesting other thing to use. Look at, get a support group if you have thoughts of suicide or depression. There's a new study that just came out I was watching last night. And if you're a drug abuser, I'm talking heroin, cocaine, crack, something like that, the new biggest thing they're saying is to go out into public and find help amongst others. It's not that you want to use drugs, it's that you have nothing else to distract you. So if you're holed up all the time, studies have shown that you're more likely to use and abuse drugs because you're not finding something else to entertain yourself with.
That's actually quite enlightening. But I guess the moral of that story is if you take proton pump inhibitors and you don't want to possibly have an increased chance of dying, you might want to stop taking them. Because if you have been taking them, the damage has already been done.
Do your research. Find out what other methods are out there to help you. Make sure you study, study, study. It's like going back to school.
Something I've been forgetting is linking these stories in the comments. So there we go. There's the first one we spoke of. Let me get to copy link. All right. One more. All right, and I'll try to do this as we bring up the comments or the stories going forward. All right. So, those are the first three stories we spoke about already. Let's go ahead and get on over to the next one that we've got. So,
this was personally my favorite. If it's this the one you're,
yeah, the Tom Hardy one.
So, oh, yes.
So, all right. So, there's going to be a new TV series. I can't remember. I read the article just last night. What network was it going to be on?
I don't remember them saying.
I don't think they did either. But there is going to Belltale Entertainment.
BBC. Yes. Distributed BBC? By BBC.
Okay,
yep.
BBC. Okay, so there's going to be a new... There's going to be a TV show coming out with Tom Hardy starring as... a World War II British SAS soldier. He was one of the initial, like, first SAS soldiers there were in, you know, England or the UK.
Lieutenant Colonel Blair Paddy Maine.
Yep, Lieutenant Colonel Paddy. Yeah, that right there. So, it's just them telling about this guy, like, one of his supervisors. He's actually one of the most decorated soldiers in British history. He got... which one of the UK's highest awards, like twice or three times. I should have taken notes last night, but I didn't. I was, he got the, one of the, England's highest awards. He wasn't given their, basically what would be considered.
He was
like,
awarded the Victoria Cross.
Yes, the Victoria Cross. He wasn't awarded what would be considered their Medal of Honor because, of the actions that took place in the situation where he would have been given that award, he actually went and killed several.
gunned down dozens of unarmed German fighters during a party at an airfield in the Libyan desert.
And actually also killed multiple of them execution style. He was just a freaking a brute of a dude. And one of his supervisors... was known to comment on him saying he was a 240-pound bag of...
highly volatile human explosive.
Yes, highly volatile human explosive.
He was also... they were also calling him a hard-drinking killer.
Hold on, I think Connor wants to come on the show.
The man loved his alcohol.
He's the British guy. Let's see if we can get him a call. There he is. What's up, Connor?
What's up?
So, yeah, Cameron, do you know Connor?
I guess not. I think he's dead.
Cameron! Oh, wait. We lost Cameron in the call. Hold on.
You dumb man. I'm professional.
I know. Why did it not bring him back in?
Because you're shit at running the show, goddammit.
Okay, hold on. Is Cameron here now?
Oh, yeah, I'm here.
Hold on, I did that all wrong. all right, there we go. Now we're getting him in here.
But the SAS movie is screenwritten by Stephen Knight, who also created the Peaky Blinders TV series. If you're familiar with that, you know his show style. I enjoyed watching Tom Hardy in that show. I also enjoy Tom Hardy as an actor in general. He goes through some extreme body transformations for every part he's played. He dives head in, so it'll be very interesting to see how he pulls this role off.
Yep. So, hey, Cameron, do you know Connor?
Connor. I do not believe I'm familiar with Connor.
Okay. So, Connor, he's another dude. He's on the show every now and then. He's also in our server. It's Neutral Fob. You'll probably hear Josh talking about him every now and then, call him neutral. He is from England, and conveniently, he popped in just as we were talking about a story from England. So,
Damn it. I'm going. Bye.
But have you heard of that show? I don't know if it... I actually don't think we heard the name of it, but it's about the founding members of the British SAS, and it's going to have Tom Hardy as the lead role.
I have not heard that.
Oh, okay. You might
it's based off the book SAS Rogue Heroes, written in 2016.
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't even read the book, to be honest. I don't know how to read.
Oh.
So...
Let's go over our alphabet today, ladies and gentlemen. A, B.
I know the Canadian alphabet, because C is got it.
Or we can go through the phonetic alphabet, Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, Delta.
Well, Connor's alphabet's a little bit differently. They have a letter in there called Z.
Yes.
Well, good for you. You'll get your cookie in the mail later.
So, let's see here. We said we were going to skip that one.
Next up should be the Tesla electric jet.
Yes, the Tesla electric jet. Have you heard anything about that, Cameron?
I know that Tesla's stupid as hell.
No, actually, well, so here's what's going on with that, the Tesla jet. So Tesla, 10 years ago, I believe it was, fucking Elon Musk went and he started doing all the calculations to figure out what it would take to be able to have a plane fly and, you know, be able to maintain flight on batteries alone. What he found is the power to weight ratio of batteries is less than what you get with fuel. However, the power to weight ratio that you have with engines on an electric is higher than what you have for the engines on, or motor, as it were, with electric, and then engines with gas, would be lower than that would be with batteries. So he went and calculated it up, and if my memory serves me correctly, he calculated that you would need 500, it was 500 pounds of thrust for each pound of, or kilogram of weight for the plane. And right now, batteries are at 400. So he's saying within the next 5 years, we should be able to have battery-powered airplanes. And with that, it will reduce generally emissions that are put out throughout the planet by, it was like 20%, I do believe they said.
It was 2% for the aviation industry and another 16.5% if he can continue on with the road-based vehicles turning into electric, predicting that in 5 years he'd be able to reduce emissions by 20% overall.
Yep, which that's freaking something big. I mean, you can be one of those people who believes in climate change or doesn't believe in climate change, whatever, you know, that's up to you. That's whatever you want to think on it. But, I mean, either way, regardless, the pollution needs to be cut down anyway, because in areas where there is high population and not as many trees and all that stuff, you get the pollution is just ridiculous.
You can literally see the smog. Look at China.
Yeah.
And San Francisco.
I mean, but China, there was a story where a man went out with a specialized filter, took a vacuum, vacuumed for a couple days, wound up going back home and was able to create a brick. And I'm talking a decent size, like 6x8x10 inch brick.
Damn.
Of the emissions he pulled out of the city. That's why so many people over there are having to wear masks just for the fact that they're that bad. Mm-hmm. While America gets crapped on all the time for our emissions, we actually constantly take so many different ways to reduce our emissions. And I mean, if you look at coal emissions, they're very minimal. They have multiple safety protocols in place to almost eliminate entirely the emissions coming out of these power plants.
Yep. Well, and also I'd heard something, this was probably a good 10-ish years ago, I'd say, that they had some development of an algae, right, that it consumes carbon monoxide, but then with the consumption of the carbon monoxide, it then excretes an oil, like a petroleum type project product.
I remember, yes, I remember seeing that story.
So, and then it was talking about how, you know, using those as scrubbers on, you know, coal power plants and all that stuff to get the CO2 or the, you know, carbon monoxide out of the stacks, and then, you know, have a supply of oil. And I was sitting there back, I was younger at that time, and I was like, you know what would be awesome? Find a really busy stretch of highway with, like, you know, land next to it, and you just build like a algae farm out there, right? So the emissions from the cars driving by will be consumed by the algae, helping keep the area clean and unpolluted, and then creating oil, which you can then sell. What in the world is that? Go answer. Yeah, that's your mom. So, and that would be pretty, you know, I thought that would be a pretty neat idea, but I don't think it would quite work out that way as easily.
Here's a problem with the Tesla powered jet, though. You've seen how cars react to like auto driving and shit. Imagine that as a plane around towers.
Yeah. It'll be interesting to see what kind of safety protocol they put in place for these jets. I mean, he's predicting 5 years. We'll see. All we can do is wait. I think some of my most favorite stories are about green energy. Now we're experimenting with waves and being able to produce kinetic energy through the movement of waves or through water. They're talking about putting basically buoys out on piers that are bouncing up and down constantly. We've had the hydroelectric for a while, but this is they're talking about a new buoyant way to get electricity from the ocean. My other two favorite stories are some of these green energies we have. What people don't understand is some of these wind turbines, actually most of them, have grease and oil in them to help the lubrication process. It is not 100% green, and they have caught fire, they've exploded, they've collapsed. What they don't tell you about solar farms is some of the solar farms are producing so much heat off the top of those solar panels, they are killing birds mid-flight, literally cooking birds alive.
Damn. We have a couple solar farms here in the Central Oregon area. So there's one... Dude. Sorry. There's one out here between Redmond and Bend, and then there's one out on the... want to say it's the... My directions are all fucked up. East of Bend, I do believe, is where that one's at. Tristan, can you stop, please? Okay, so here I am. All right, so... But another thing with that battery stuff is there's been a lot of discussion lately on the probability that like Space Force and NASA and all that stuff are going to be working towards trying to mine asteroids for the resources on them to be able to build bigger and better batteries.
We wish Elon Musk all the luck in the world.
Well, I guess there's also apparently a big old massive asteroid that's all gold that would supposedly be able to make everyone on the planet a trillionaire. But then,
yeah,
in that sense, like
which everybody, makes money worthless.
Yeah,
currency will go up, and then people who are a trillionaire won't.
It doesn't matter anymore because now your milk is $500 a gallon.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what I was thinking every single time I saw it. I was like, that would be counterproductive. So,
money doesn't go up just because we make more of it.
Mm-hmm. So.
That's why the minimum wage increase controversy is very entertaining to read.
Mm-hmm.
Because what they don't... If you gave... These minimum wage jobs are not meant to be a full lifetime job. They're meant for the high schoolers and college kids to get some extra beer money.
Mm-hmm.
If you raise minimum wage to $15 an hour, that $3-$4 burger you're getting at McDonald's is now $9 and $10.
Well, see, we went on to a big segue, but that is, you know, that is true and that is understandable. But at the same point, I remember I read an article a couple of years ago, it was probably, saying how in the 1950s it was expected that, you know, a family of four and you know, around this time frame, should be able to survive very well, very comfortably off of one person in the household working, and they didn't even have to work a full-time job, just basically having a job, and they would be able to raise a family of four extremely comfortably.
Now, because a house only cost a couple $1,000s, and a cars were hundreds of dollars. I mean, $500, $600, $700 for a vehicle.
Yep.
And it was a brand new vehicle.
Yeah. And but now with the way things are going, is you know, you need two, you know, people in a household of four working full time in order to really survive extremely comfortably. So, but yeah.
In 1960, U.S. inflation rate, in other words, in 1960, $100 was equivalent to $799.78 in 2014.
So, how much was it? $100 is equivalent to $700 in 2014?
Almost $800 in 2014. $100 in 1960 was equivalent to $800 in 2014. That was only 5 years ago.
Damn. Kind of crazy. Well, I guess moving on from that segue.
Went a little deeper into that one than we thought we would.
Moving right along. All right.
Although our next one should be a fairly quick topic. I didn't get too much out of this one myself.
Farming Simulator 19. This was, I guess this was just kind of just a mention type thing, just to pop it out there. Like, in the Farming Simulator 19, it's a sim game where, you know, you have a farm, you hop on a tractor, and you farm. It's, you know, same type of simulator as Flight Simulator or all that stuff.
I think I had the old Farming Simulators. Can't remember.
Say that again, Connor?
I think I had Farming Simulator at one point.
Did you? Well, it's saying that the 2019 version of it sold over 2 million copies. So which is telling me either a lot of farmers like to spend time in their spare time acting like they're farming, or there's a lot of people out there who wish they were farmers but just want to play a game on it.
Right. I've worked on a couple
modern API on it. So
I've worked on a couple farms. I guarantee half the people playing the game would actually go out there and be like, no, no. I'm not doing that. I'm not shoveling cow shit all day.
Say no.
I work on farms all the time. It's fun.
I agree. It's entertaining to actually get out there, handle some of the cattle. Cattle was probably one of the more entertaining ones I ever did. They're, you know, big, dumb animal. You feed them, clean them, and half the time, they're afraid of you.
Yeah.
Bulls, on the other hand, no. They don't. If you can't make it across that field in 10 seconds, he will.
Yep.
So
I worked on a cow farm before, and all I did was fucking milk. I mean, fucking hell.
I worked on a meat cattle farm, so I didn't have to deal with the milking part.
It's a stunk.
However, hauling them hay bales out there and trying to get the cows to stop eating the netting while you're trying to get the hay shook out is a little annoying. The net's not good for you. Stop eating it.
So I haven't really worked much on a farm, but then again, at the same point, like, I'm kind of person, I don't really want to be doing a lot of work outside when it's cold, so I'd rather live in a place where it doesn't get cold or work in a job where I'm inside.
Come on down to Texas where it gets to 100 degrees with 80% humidity. We'll change that thought real quick.
Where you can cook a steak on top of a fucking like sidewalk.
I'm okay with
Put a steak in your car. Go work an 8-hour shift. I used to be an iron worker. And when you're laying out that decking, it gets hotter than hell. And there is no shade up there. You could probably put a steak out on the hood of your car. At the end of your 8-hour day, it's probably going to be done.
Well, it's like, I lived in Guam for, you know, 4 years, so I know humidity, and then, like, you know, Redding, that's a place where it'll get, you know, 110, 115 every single year. They don't have as high humidity there, but, and I've always liked the higher temperatures. I do not like snow whatsoever, but
as I was telling Athan earlier, I wish I could find the old, we had a Coast Guard when I worked on tugboats, we had a chart that would list temperatures, humidity, and a time frame that you were allowed to work outside. So if it was over this temperature and humidity, you couldn't work outside for 2 hours without taking a 15-minute break in either shade or air conditioning.
Yeah, the
black. I would love, if I could get my hands on that and share it around to these companies today, I think half of them would lose their minds because now they're having to actually worry about, because when I was an iron worker, I had a guy fall out twice because he couldn't get hydrated enough and he wasn't even doing too much hard work. It just gets that hot. And a lot of the foremen that I've seen and a lot of companies that I've been around, your foreman or your captain, they're inside most of the time. They're in a vehicle with the AC on. They're in the wheelhouse. So they're not experiencing these environmental issues like the rest of the people. And yes, they may have come from that line of work, but it also didn't get as bad back then. And now they're slave driving people to the point where, you know, you can't stay hydrated. People are having muscle spasms, cramps, showing signs of heat stroke.
Yep.
And it's becoming more and more concerning, especially with the rise in temperatures. I mean, we had maybe 3-4 days last winter in South Texas where you might have needed a jacket. Christmas was 70-something degrees.
Oh, damn.
Yeah.
We didn't. We were still pretty darn cold and got quite a bit of snow this last winter. Yeah,
I mean, I've seen snow in Houston, I think 4 or 5 times, and I have lived here most of my life, and it is becoming much, much rarer to see temperatures below 50.
Yeah. Damn. Like, I don't think we hit really anywhere in the single digits this last winter, but we did get like 4 or 5 foot of snow. So. And then it'll usually, usually most winters, it does actually end up dropping down into like single digits into negative digits. I had a couple pictures from a couple years ago, me going to work in the morning and it was, you know, negative 13 degrees.
God. However, there are some, I was scrolling through Facebook, earlier. I saw an interesting article. Apparently cities have been painting the streets white in an effort to reduce the heat. And it's been showing that it's dropping the temperatures of the roads 15, 20 degrees. It was a huge, it was absolutely surprising to see how much of a difference changing the color of the road was effective for that city.
That makes sense because with the black, then the water or the sunlight and the heat's going to get absorbed into the blacktop and then just be held and keep it hot.
Yeah.
So I guess that makes sense. If with the white, there's not as much heat going to be absorbed into it. I mean, white will still get hot. But
yeah, hopefully we'll start expanding that out more and more and start to actually see temperature effects drop a little bit in high populated locations with a lot of blacktop.
Okay. Well, that's awesome. I guess we'll move forward on to this one. This one is actually a story that has two stories to it. So we'll cover them at the same time. So, we've got, it's the new the Spider-Man game on PS4 got a couple costumes out of it for the release of the new Spider-Man movie.
Far From Home.
Yeah, Far From Home.
There you go.
So they took a couple of the costumes from that, and then they put it into the game. It was a free download that you could get for your guy in the Spider-Man game. And then the other part of it is in the Spider-Man game, no, in the movie, there was a nod to the Spider-Man game. So they're kind of like tying it back and forth. I didn't catch what it was that they did inside the movie for the game, though.
They threw a little Easter egg in there in the movie, and it was Spider-Man doing the peace symbol. You know, in the game, he's on the train, and in the movie, apparently, I haven't seen it yet, but they showed the photo. He was on top of a skyscraper taking a selfie, doing the peace sign, and they commented saying, "Should you really be shooting webs and texting at the same time?"
Yeah, right.
So,
well, because yeah. And it's like because. I didn't really read into the article that far to find it because the article has spoilers for Endgame and Far From Home, and I didn't want to do that because I haven't seen even Endgame yet. So, waiting for that to come out on DVD. So, hey Connor, do you still play Apex Legends?
No, barely. But I barely even touched that game.
Oh, you barely touched it? Because they're going
Yeah.
into season two, and they got a we got an article up on it for what they're getting with the new battle pass. I didn't really play Apex Legends myself either. Did you play it at all there, Cameron?
No, not in particular. I didn't really care for it. I saw too many ties that looked like Halo guns, and I kind of felt like it was ripping off of other genres, pulling things from, here and here and here and here to throw together a game. However, some of the new things that they are adding in the new season, they're adding ranked leagues for people. And I know that in some of the games I play, especially my roommate, he loves playing ranked because he wants to see how good he is in comparison to everybody else that plays. So if you enjoy that kind of gameplay, that's a new mod for the you, and you can see how well you do against everybody. Instead of talking all the smack you want, now you can actually back up what you're saying.
So, and another thing, when I was looking at that article, I was noticing that the layout of the battle pass for so we got Bit or Brian Big Country Conwell watching. Thank you for watching. Not much, very much over there. What are you up to yourself, dude? Where was I at? So we've got oh yeah, the battle pass there in Apex Legends seems to be laid out quite a bit like the battle pass or the rocket pass in Rocket League is. So it's like you get the battle pass and you have two levels, the one you pay for and the free one. And you earn free stuff at each level of doing it, and then there will be challenges that'll get you other free stuff and things like that. So I think that's pretty neat. But like you said, they're just kind of, it did look like they were just kind of taking pieces of different games and throwing them together.
That's why I'm excited for Halo to finally actually come to Steam so I can play with all my old friends again. And, you've got Halo was a classic for me, and I absolutely love the gameplay. Same with Gears of War. I wish that one would come to Steam as well, but there's no mention of that anywhere, so I'll have to be disappointed on that for a while.
What were your feelings on Apex Legends there, Connor?
I like the idea, but then it started reminding me of Fortnite,
He is right, though. Some of the things that they were providing in the new battle passes were skins, dance moves, and songs. Like, why? That makes absolutely no sense. The skins I can understand for your characters and your guns makes you look cool, makes you stand out. All right, awesome. But I'm not going to go play a game where you can dance and play music in front of people to taunt them. I'm there. If I'm playing an FPS, I want to just shoot people. I'm there. I love realistic first person shooters. I play a few of them, and we'll get into that in a little bit. But you're gonna stand on top of a tree and dance. I'm sorry. That's insulting to gamers everywhere. Yes, I get it. It's entertaining, but it's also causing a more toxic community in online gaming.
And there's a lot of toxicity in gaming anyways. Even worse when you get into console, but like I'll notice it in like Rainbow Six Siege. You get a lot of toxicity in there, especially when you get kids that are in there and all they want to do is be annoying. Fucking yeah. But
Don't play Smite. Oh, okay. That's toxic as hell.
Toxicity didn't used to be as bad, man, and it's such a disappointment to see how it's coming out into the world
Because
today.
people hide behind PC screens now, and they probably
Exactly.
like back in the day, you would talk to your friend would kick the shit out of you.
And the loser bought the beer, and it was done. Now you fight, the cops are coming, both parties are getting arrested. If you win, now you've got to worry about this guy coming back with friends or a gun. It's the world's changing, and everybody's getting into their feelings and their emotions. And if this offends you, then you're wrong because it offends me. It's not supported by facts and evidence, and it's just causing more and more depreciation of the friendships we create with other people. It's hard to be friends with a Republican and a Democrat at the same time because now they don't want to talk about it. They want to scream at each other, scream you're wrong, and there's no intellectual conversation behind any of it. There's no fact statement. There's no evidence backing it up. So if we could get back to that, that would be beautiful, but I don't see it happening in my lifetime, which is a shame.
So yeah, I know. I don't see it happening either. There's too much connectivity now throughout everyone for that to actually be able to happen. It's in a lot of, we segued way far. I'll get back into topic here in a second. But it's like, I've mentioned it before. It's like with the interconnectivity that we have in humanity right now through social media and all that stuff, you have cliques that get set up. So, you know, you have your conservative people that are going to hang out with like-minded conservative people. And then your liberals and then everyone else, you know, you got the veterans cliques and all that stuff. Everyone kind of clicks together and they get their own community going and they start, you know, pushing their ideas and then, you know, going effectively to war with another community that doesn't agree with them. It's a whole lot of big just piles of shit, you know?
And I mean, imagine the platforms we have. I mean, there's Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, there's platforms everywhere. Mm-hmm. Imagine if you became positive, how many friends you could create. There are certain topics you should just avoid. Religion, politics, just certain things like that you know it's going to cause some controversy. Don't talk about them. If you think it's going to bring some heat, then don't talk about them.
Exactly.
You could be friends with a guy in China, mm-hmm, because you decide you found something. Y'all play Rocket League or Siege together, and y'all love playing that. And now y'all play together regularly. I remember reading a story. What game was he? A PC gamer. I can't remember what game they were playing. Had passed away, and these guys had never met in person. But while he was in the hospital, all his friends actually got together. They got the money. They flew in, visited him at the hospital. I mean, it brought me to tears. Mm-hmm. It was absolutely beautiful to see what can really happen when you don't focus on your differences, but you focus on what you like together.
Yeah, and it created such a strong...
No, he had, if I remember right, he had cancer.
I think it was a guy in... cancer. I think it was WoW where that happened. And then when he passed, they did a big old huge memorial in the game for him.
Mm-hmm. It was just beautiful.
Yep.
To see something that brought so many people together.
Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what our mission is with all this, is, you know, to do that. I mean, hell, we got a dude, I'm doing a radio show with a guy from England. I've never actually met him. He's a really cool guy. What's your name again?
Fuck you.
So, but yeah.
I mean, you and me, Ethan, haven't actually met, but I remember the first time we started talking, watched your show live while y'all were playing Rocket League, started giving y'all shit, and you were like, come on, bring it on in.
Yep.
Jumped in, and we just went from there.
Exactly.
Now I'm doing live shows with you.
Yep.
I mean, I played a terrible video game, so you're not hard to give me shit. I beat him in a 1v1 on Rainbow Six Siege with no sound. And I beat his ass.
Oh.
I had sound off too, by the way.
I mean, that didn't matter.
He's been getting better at Rocket League. I'll give him that. He's still a little oblivious on some
I don't play that game, but I'll suck his ass.
I don't think he'd kick my ass on Rocket League. I mean, and that's, you know, what everything's going. We're just trying to freaking have a community that's positive and all that stuff. I wanted to jump back a few steps real quick. And mentioned something about what we were talking a little bit ago. But before I do that, I wanted to say another thing. You know, it's like, and also through this last couple of weeks with everything that I've been going through, Cameron, you've been a huge help also. So, you know, it's just friends like that are what are awesome. So, but going back a little bit earlier into this stuff, you know, how you were talking about how Apex Legends is looking like it's just kind of a copy of, like, say, Fortnite. Well, Fortnite's got, like, the winning recipe, I guess you could say. They're winning, you know, whatever, to make a game that is going to get all kinds of people playing and spending money on it. Now it's just a race to see who can copy that formula and make it better than what the original was. And I think Apex Legends thought they had that, and they're actually doing pretty good as far as that goes, I think.
Apex Legends is very popular. I have to give them that. Whatever formula they're using it right. Mm-hmm. I just, and again, this is just my opinion. You can call me wrong. You can call me a dumbass all you want. I really don't care. But it just looked too much like it was pulling from other games. And I, you know, I
basically taking Fortnite and then went, you know what, let's add Titanfall to it. Done.
We're gonna take Fortnite, Halo, Gears of War, Doom. Fuck. We're gonna pull everything out from history. Maybe they won't notice. Some of us older gamers kind of notice these things, you guys. You got to give us something new to work with, which is making it. I have to say though, it is making it very hard for new games to come out because so many of the old games did phenomenal when they were created.
So, I guess we're gonna. Yeah, a lot of the older games did do phenomenal in there, but I mean, like that was Halo. Halo had the winning formula for a good period of time, and then. Call of Duty came out. Call of Duty took Halo's throne. And Call of Duty was the top dog in the shooter area for quite a while. And now Call of Duty is starting to fall off. And with the new Call of Duty game they're dropping here in October, looks like
they're trying to.
I know. It looks like they're trying to take that throne back. So, I mean, and right now there's not really a top dog on the shooter in the shooter genre, is there? There's not, like, the big. I mean, I guess Call of Duty would still be it, kind of, huh?
No, I mean, I'm seeing a lot of streamers that love PUBG still. I've seen a lot of Siege, Fortnite. I'm not a fan of watching the Fortnite ones because building and getting shot at the same time is ridiculous to me. It doesn't work. I can't wrap my mind around that concept, but some people can. I jump into that game and I'd go like Athan did when I brought him into a new game, 0 and 23.
Yeah, American Army. I got my face pounded.
We'll get into those free games later, though. We've got some free games to talk about in a little bit, and we'll get into those then. I think we want to move on to the next topic.
Yeah, let's move on to the next story. This one's about marijuana. So, it's a study.
Oh yeah.
About how hell yeah, you're from England, you're not allowed to do that stuff.
Hey, I've got CBD right now. That's good enough for now.
So I have to admit, I started taking the CBD oil while my back was causing me problems, and it originally, before my back started getting worse, it was definitely helping me sleep. So this is from personal experience, just the CBD oil alone. And I suffer from night terrors after the military. I wake up in the morning, it looks like I went 10 rounds with, you know, the Rock in my bed. Take that however you want it. I'm going to leave it at that. But it, you know, I was having so many problems staying in one spot, restless leg syndrome, you know. But I started taking these drops. And I felt so much more well-rested. I woke up refreshed, finally. I wasn't waking up, and it wasn't like, God, I feel like I just went to bed. How is it 6, 7, 8, 12 hours later? Mm-hmm. I woke up, and I'm like, man, all right, let's go kick ass at some video games. Let's go get some groceries. Mm-hmm. Let's do something. I felt good.
Yep.
So from just personal experience from CBD oil alone, this isn't even the topic we're going into. I mean, we're still talking about THC and marijuana, but some of the byproducts already have been super beneficial. My dad suffers from rheumatoid arthritis, has to take chemo. He has to take all these different pills. And it is so depressing to see. I you know, he watching him grow up, my dad and me didn't get along a lot. But he's always been supportive. He's always been there for my back, even when I was screwing up. But when you're young, dumb, and full of cum, you don't know these things. You don't notice. You don't think you're wrong. And now seeing him and looking back, it's so depressing to see him this way. But after he started taking the CBD oil, I mean, his color's coming back. His smile's back. His neck is looking cleaner. I mean, my dad has become my hero because even with all these problems, with just a little bit of help from something that used to be illegal, I'm telling him, you've got to live until I get married. My brother's married. My sister's married. You've got to stay around. And it's such a relief to see him doing better, even through the chemo.
I know chemo can be a rough situation for people. But moving along into the story,
actual story, ladies and gentlemen.
So this is
sorry,
about.
Sorry about that.
This is about, does marijuana actually improve sleep? So there was a peer-reviewed study of 1,000 people that they did this on, and it was basically when people were going into a dispensary in Colorado to buy weed. The people who were doing the study would ask them as they were coming out, you know, what are you buying weed for, and all that stuff. And do you think it helps you sleep? Do you think it helps you with pain? And then they would calculate the answers. It was an overwhelming 84% in the survey that said
86% of Americans say marijuana has medical benefits. Mm-hmm. That's not just the sleep.
Mm-hmm.
There's been cases with seizures, strokes, cancer patients that have changed their diet, have started taking THC drops, and they've gone into remission. I mean, there's been multiple studies. They're still saying that there's not enough evidence entirely, but they're looking at doing more and more trials. However, some of the statistics we're going to give you today are overwhelmingly positive.
Yep.
I mean, I think the lowest number I saw was 74%.
Mm-hmm. I think that was as far as pain goes, because it's saying it's, you know, they asked, Do you use marijuana for sleep? You know, yes or no. And then if you do use it for sleep, do you think it actually worked? It says the survey found that 74% of the 1,000 people interviewed bought marijuana to help them sleep. 84% said the marijuana had helped them, and 83% said that they had since reduced or stopped taking sleep aids. So that's just like,
Again, going back to our original story about medicines over the counter and heartburn. Some of these sleep aids people take, if you read the ingredients and some of the side effects, they're not that positive. And some of them are addictive.
Mm-hmm. So, only sleep aids I've ever taken were melatonin. And even then, like, I tried taking some CBD gummies for a little bit. The gummies would just fucking rock my world too hard. Like, I would fall asleep and be asleep for an entire day.
Obviously they helped you sleep.
but the melatonin would usually help me out fairly well, but I haven't been taking any of that lately.
Here's the two favorite statistics I pulled out of this whole article.
Okay.
Is that 82% of the people stopped taking over-the-counter medications when they started taking marijuana. Mm-hmm. So again, that gets rid of all those bad side effects you can read from the back of the bottles, and 88% of people that had started taking marijuana stopped taking opioids.
Yep. So, and there's been some correlation to that too, but that's kind of a double-edged sword to an extent, because, like, yes, you could say that, you know, they people were able to switch over to using marijuana as opposed to opioids, but then at the same point, there's a lot of people that have, after a little while, the high and all that stuff of the marijuana is not matching up, and they're going to fall back into the opioids with it too. So, I mean, there's a lot more studies and all that stuff, research that has to be done on that part. I mean, everything. I mean, you know, as overwhelming as these results are, it was only 1,000 people. So, but, you know, it's still really good numbers, really interesting numbers. And also, I saw some stuff scrolling through Facebook today that about, what was I going to say? How there is a bill going up here in the next election for legalizing marijuana federally. So that's pretty neat.
It is. It's going to be challenging with people that are going to wind up abuse it, you know, people driving under the influence and stuff like that. You know, don't drink and drive, obviously, but don't smoke and drive as well.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Don't go to work high. You know, it's going to be a lot of it's going to be self-checked. Be responsible. Be aware of what you're doing, and do not abuse. It's still a drug. Don't abuse it. Use it as necessary. That's why I'm more fond of the drops, because certain edibles, because I had a lot of people in high school that smoked, and they would just Token.
That's kind of,
you know,
that's all they did.
That's basically who they become. They let marijuana define their lives.
Mm-hmm.
So I can fully agree with it becoming medicinal. However, becoming recreational, I'm still kind of on the fence on that one, for the fact that it is super hard to regulate.
My opinion on it is, I mean, it is hard to regulate. I mean, there's not really any set in stone way that I know of to test of, if you're currently under the influence of it. I mean, and it's just common sense stuff, like, anything else, just like alcohol. And frankly, I'm gonna go out here and say my personal opinion is marijuana is much less dangerous and much less of a potential issue than alcohol is. But
Fully agree with you on that one.
it is like, same thing. What you it's you're not gonna be you shouldn't be doing it at work or going to work high. That's, if you're doing it in those types of scenarios, those types of situations, you have a problem. So, marijuana, as far as I know, and all I've heard, marijuana is not itself addictive. However, people themselves can be easily addicted. And
And as far as the like deaths go, there's only been one case I've heard of, and even still, the link to marijuana, she was using a Juul or a vape pen, something like that, and they were trying to say it was the THC, but now they're going into studies and starting to find out that something could have been wrong with her medically, with her lungs, and how she was taking it. So, one case in
Yeah, it's the only other
many,
story.
many, many
We
years.
covered that story on the actual, actually the last show we did before all the drama started. But it's like,
Quick shout out to Jamie Rice. He says, "Hey, that it's 17 0700 somewhere, sailor. Let me put that on a t-shirt for you." Hey, Jamie, it's 1700 somewhere, but I would 100%, and I think Athan agrees, we would love to see those t-shirts. Maybe we could start selling them as well.
Maybe we could. We can give that a try. So, I mean, I've been wanting to find a way to get some t-shirts and stuff like that made for it. Well, I'm gonna work into all that. We're trying to make things a lot more serious, a lot more for real on all this as we move forward. So,
So Jamie, we love the suggestion. Shoot Athan or me personally. Name's Cameron Bates. You should be able to find me tagged somewhere. Send us the photos, send us the designs, and hopefully we can help get this funded and get this going.
So, Connor, you didn't get to have your thoughts and opinions on this, like the whole marijuana and all that stuff. Let's hear what you have to say about
I mean, good shit.
that.
Sounds like a personal user right there.
Well, there you go. That's Connor's opinion.
I should probably not say this since it's illegal over here, but I totally don't smoke weed every single time I get a chance to. Just covering my back right now.
This sounds like some military stuff again. I can neither confirm nor deny.
Neither can confirm
Can't
nor
even confirm, no, can't even confirm or deny that I do smoke this shit. It's
Well,
good
Connor,
shit.
we appreciate that you do or do not with your yes or no opinion. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's another one that you can take with a grain of salt or a margarita.
A grain of salt on a margarita.
Mmm.
I want to get have a Bloody Mary at some point. I
Oh.
didn't used to ever like Bloody Marys, but I don't know. I think my tastes and stuff are starting to evolve because I'm starting to actually like tomatoes now. So there's a chance I might actually make a like a Bloody Mary now. I might need to try
I
some.
can make a mean mojito. I
Yeah.
love mojitos. You can call me a bitch all you want, but mojitos are absolutely delicious. The trick is using coconut spiced rum, not just a normal white rum.
Okay,
You get a
nice.
little bit, you get that little bit sweeter kick to it because it only calls for a little bit of sugar, but you add that coconut spice, it gives that little flavor to it. I bartended for about a year, and while I was doing it, my brother's high school friend brought me over for some bachelor party or some shit, and I warned every single one of the women, I make them strong, about three fingers worth of rum. I make them strong. And I told them, do not suck these down. Don't do it. Do not do it.
Do it.
Slam
None
them.
of them, none of them listen to me. They're three and four in, and they're starting to get a little funny. So it was hilarious too. I can hold my alcohol. Then why does it look like that bar table is holding you up right now? Because it is.
Gonna have to try to figure out something about the light. Well, I'm gonna be moving here soon anyway, so I guess that'll get figured out on its own. That's not here, neither here nor there right now. I've been watching this channel on YouTube. It's called How to Drink, and it's a dude. He says he's never been a bartender, never worked in a bar, but he's been in bars a lot. The videos are just him making up new drinks every single week and or every single episode, and it's actually pretty awesome. Let's go ahead and start moving forward. And Terrell Guell, what's up, dude? Thank you for joining. Thank you for watching. I guess we'll move on to the next story then.
Red Dead Redemption.
Red Dead Redemption. Oh, okay.
Red Dead Redemption. For those of you who love Easter eggs, and if you've ever watched Ready Player One, that movie is filled with Easter eggs.
It is.
And for all the old gamers, you know, if you glitch out of an area in a game, you're usually stuck in limbo and you're trying to find a way to kill yourself to get back into the game to be able to continue to play, or you have to leave and go back to your save point. Red Dead Redemption did something unique, and it is beautiful. You can look up the photos in the link. They are phenomenal. There's an area where you can glitch and squeeze just outside the boundaries and discover they claim it to be a never-ending expanse of land and some random cube.
Yeah, it was in the air, just a random cube chilling in the air. So, but yeah.
For our Easter egg hunters, I highly, highly want you to go and find them, get photos, send them to me. I want to see what you found.
We can start putting stuff like that on Instagram and shit like that, too. Because we do have
an Instagram for the show. Any Easter egg. Any game you play, you find an Easter egg, we want to see them.
Yep. So let's go ahead and get those being sent to us. But yeah, it's like, from what I saw, the pictures in there were some pictures of like canyons with actual roads in them and everything like that. It's like a fully developed landscape, but there's no buildings or anything in it. So they just developed.
It looks remarkably like the Grand Canyon. Just untouched, beautiful clouds. I mean, it looked stunning.
What is this? I got a message. Let me check it. What is that? Oh? Machine Gun Kelly does something? Oh, Lord.
Oh. Oh, Machine Gun Kelly's dead.
MGK
Yeah. Oh, God.
Apparently, MGK just dropped a track dissing Eminem.
So, that's not even one of our topics for the day, but I'm getting into this. I don't care. Eminem, every time he's been called out by anybody, he has gone ham on somebody for calling him out, dissing him in a track, and Eminem has been out since I was a little kid, and he has rocked the rap world, being the first white rapper to just blow people out of the water. And it's funny seeing all these new guys, especially the ones that are Lil Xan, Lil Nas, all these little kids that mumble rap, go against an actual rapper with lyrics and heart. And you can still tell there's some soul in it because it was rap. It's not the crap we have out today where mumble, mumble, mumble. And it sounds like it rhymes. It was, you could understand him and he was saying a message and he meant every word of it.
So, well, but you know, MGK and Eminem, they already had a battle this it was this year. They already, like, Eminem put a track out on his new album that he dropped this year, that was dissing on MGK. MGK came back and actually did a whole song dissing on Eminem, and then Eminem came back with another whole song dissing on MGK, the one that Eminem dropped after MGK's was called Killshot, and that's what this is about. I guess MGK just dropped an album, and on it there's a song called Floor 13 where he put in the lyrics, let me find it, one of the lyrics to it was, I just spent too many minutes watching little videos of shitty wannabe rappers dissing me. I just spent the winter living after someone tried to send a kill shot missing me. So yep. So, I mean, MGK got some stones, dude.
You got to give him that for going after Eminem. He's got some balls. But there's a fine line between bravery and stupidity, and some people out there just like to play jump rope with that line.
Yep.
One of the funny things I find about today's rappers, a lot of them have their faces tattooed and stuff like that. There is a reference to almost all of them that they look like the old desk in middle school and high school you used to doodle on. And they look just like it. They got these random little things all over them trying to look hard. And then look at the, what's that rainbow?
Oh, Tekashi 6ix9ine? Looking.
Yeah, that guy wound up going to jail, and he's starting to snitch on everybody and their mother. He is doing everything to try and avoid jail time.
Because he was going to spend the rest of his life in prison. Yeah. He's like, no, I don't want to do that.
Back when rap was rap, you didn't snitch.
Yep.
You went, you did your time, you came out hard as hell, and you jumped back in life.
Yep. So we're getting,
and that's how we got a lot of the soul and spirit into the rap we used to have. Now today, it's just people out there for the money.
So we're getting down to some of the last few stories. I had one that I wanted to just touch on real quick. Nothing huge, nothing big. Well, unless we start to talk about it. But apparently, in China, they are installing spyware on your phones, like on tourists. So if you go into China, the Xinjiang province in China. They're at some crossings, border crossings there in that area. They have guards set up that will stop you and take your phone and install an app on it. And it goes through and it gets all your text messages and, calls and all that stuff. And it just scans your phone for any, I think it said it was like something like 76,000 different things that is a trigger for them. I guess apparently this app only works on Androids, and if you have an iPhone, they plug the iPhone into something and scan the phone like that. So yeah, if you plan on going to China, you might want to leave your phone.
Yeah.
So yeah. And then we're gonna move forward.
God bless America.
Yeah. Right. So here, moving on into this one, we've got God bless America. The CEO of Camping World said he'd rather go to jail than remove a huge flag that he has on at his office that the North Carolina is threatening him with jail if he doesn't take it down. He's like, no, screw you.
They're threatening to sue and jail time with a $50 fine for every day the flag stays up, which is absolutely ridiculous. Mm-hmm. However, we can all remember the loophole Trump found on one of the golf courses where he built a hill and then put his flagpole back up at the same height. Mm-hmm. But because there was a hill, they couldn't do anything about it.
Yep.
But with that being said, the flag is a 40 foot by 80 foot flag.
I was going to say it's a holiday
this
flag.
This thing is huge, mm-hmm. which apparently violates the city of Statesville, North Carolina's laws.
Yep. Oh, well, go ahead.
They're claiming that because of its size and the vicinity to the interstate, it is a hazard. However, if you look at it, it's quite high up there and not really in anybody's way. There's nothing it's going to block.
I think what people are upset about is people are going to see it and get distracted by it. And be like, ooh, look at the big flag. But, I mean,
yet we have billboards and flashing signs and all these different distractions around the highways, but none of, good God, you put up a flashing sign somewhere and that's not a distraction.
Right. So, but I know, I'm pretty certain there's a lot of areas that have those kinds of rules as far as flags, because when I was looking at the picture of the flag, I noticed it looked like it was a holiday flag. I get it. You want to be patriotic. I would like to fly a flag as big as I possibly could too, but
We have limits, but however, there has been 317,000 signatures of people coming together. The veterans in the area are coming together. Even just regular average Joes are coming together saying that they don't want this flag removed. Mm-hmm. So the CEO is getting backed up by hundreds of thousands of people. I say fly the flag. Let the man do what he wants to be. This is a land of the free, and they're trying to limit our freedoms. So, you know what? I want to see this man stick it to him.
Yep. So, I mean, and you're gonna be seeing this stuff happening quite a lot. It's, Everyone's got their own opinion. Everyone just wants to fight for what they think everyone should be doing, what they want. The way I see it is just do your own thing. Let people worry about themselves, not worry about, But
let's not forget the cake baker that's getting sued for the third time for refusing to make a cake. And they're saying it's violating our freedoms. Well, by trying to sue him and tell him he needs to make the cake, which he says is against his religion, you're still imposing on somebody else's religion.
Yep.
You're imposing on their freedoms.
Just go find
But you want to force it, it goes back to what we talked about earlier. They're offended. They have to be right.
Yep. I mean, and just go ahead and find someone else to make cake for you. I mean, fuck.
It's not hard. I mean, you can put into Google Maps cake maker and you'll probably get 10 people in the area that you can drive to with ease.
Yep.
Oh, don't be lazy.
Why do you have... Yeah, right. Exactly. Make it yourself. Why do you have to target this old man over and over and over? It doesn't make sense in my mind. That's... The literal definition of insanity is trying the same thing over and over and over again and expecting different results.
It's trying to impose their will on him. So now it's like, now what it is people have seen every single time someone comes to him for that, he refuses. So now everyone's like, well, let's try to make it to where he won't refuse anymore. So everyone's trying to hop in on that. And what they're expecting is eventually he's going to just get wore down by it and be like, fine, fuck it, whatever, I'll make these cakes. Or eventually there's going to be someone who brings up a lawsuit that finds a judge or jury or however it goes that will actually, in fact, rule in their favor. And, I mean, that's, I don't know.
I see him closing down at that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
That would make me lose my faith in humanity right there alone.
I think that's what it's leading to. It's just people trying to impose their will. And that's, I mean, why though? But, I mean, this is getting too far into politics now at that point on that, so I'm gonna pull the reins on it.
We're going to segue back to our next story.
So, this is an update of something that we've been covering for quite a while. This has been several months haven't been talked about. There was a United States Navy SEAL, he was Chief Eddie Gallagher. At a period of time, he was discovered, getting... tried for having murdered a ISIS fighter, a wounded ISIS fighter, and then also getting tried for having taken a picture of himself with a dead body of an ISIS fighter. This past week, he was found not guilty and on the murder, but he was actually found guilty on one count of taking a photo with a dead ISIS fighter. He was... I'm assuming he got put on restriction. Restriction only comes from NJP. This would have been a court martial.
No, he did. He wound up getting restricted. He was restricted for 4 months. However, because he was detained for almost 8 months, they had basically dropped that at that point in time.
Okay.
Because he had already been there for so long. But Trump also did help him out by getting him out of Brig and then into a less restrictive barracks, but he was still restricted to the Marine Corps Air Station.
Okay.
And then
he got the reduced rank and partial pay for 4 months. So, and partial pay and 4 months confinement. So, I mean, he got off lucky, and it doesn't sound like he got kicked out either, did he?
No, he did not. He did get busted down, though, which is a shame. Mm-hmm. However, I do have to say this. If you're going to be overseas in combat, I mean, don't take photos, guys.
Yeah, don't do that.
Don't have any kind of evidence of what you're doing over there. It's dumb. Keep it in your memories. Keep it with your stories between your buddies. But it doesn't, the more photos you take, there's more backlash that could come to you. I know when I was in the Navy on submarines, if you ever got caught trying to take any kind of a photo, good God, stand by, shipmate.
Yep. Also on submarine, everything is classified in there. Like, I was IC, I didn't have top, I had secret, and I wasn't allowed to go anywhere further than the hatch. on a submarine, and I was on a submarine tender. I could go down to the hatch, and I can't even remember if I was allowed to climb down the ladder, but
so,
that was as far as I could go.
so, Don't take your photos. I mean, this goes back to the story of Marines pissing on the dead bodies.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Why would you take photos and share them? Everybody's watching that. Somebody's going to... My old English teacher said, and I quote, "Somebody somewhere is not going to like one thing you do."
Mm-hmm.
So exactly. with the amount of social media out there, once it's out there, it's there for the world to see, guys.
Yep. And my assumption with this is, even though he did not get booted, I'm going to assume he's probably going to retire. And even as a SEAL, he's at, because he got reduced from chief to petty officer first class, he's still going to be making some pretty good money on it until he does actually retire. And he's still a SEAL. I don't think they would have taken his trident. So, I don't know.
No. They wouldn't do that. I don't see that happening.
We'll keep a little bit more updates on everything that's going on with him, if there's anything else that comes out in the future. And with that, do you have anything you want to say on that there, Connor?
Fucking social media is a bitch. Remember when I got fucking banned from this farm because I fucking shared one thing?
True. Yeah, social media is a bitch. But I don't know if he... Did he post... No, he probably didn't post it on social media, but he had cameras. And the thing with the story, like, we'll give a little bit more of an update on what it is. I'll tell a little bit more about what happened. So basically, there was a wounded ISIS fighter. Corman was taking care of him. And the story that it was brought out at first was Corman was taking care of this wounded ISIS fighter. But
he was already in critical condition.
Yeah, he was already in critical. He wasn't going to survive. So Chief Gallagher stabbed him and killed him while the Corman was working on him. And I don't know if this was the same fighter that Chief Gallagher took a picture with. Or not. I can't remember any part of that story, but then he also had a picture of himself taken with an ISIS fighter. But where it comes down to it is the other people on his team, what the story was saying was afraid of him. Initially, they had people on his team testifying that they were tampering with his rifle, removing his firing pin because he was a sniper. They were removing the firing pin from his rifle so he couldn't just randomly kill people because apparently he would just go and kill people and all that stuff. And you know, the people on his team were afraid of him. They were worried that, you know, he might hurt them and all that stuff. So they went and they told people about these things. And then all this went along. So, and I guess a lot of that stuff isn't necessarily all true. I don't know. He's got a lot of support from a lot of people. I'm sitting here looking at it. Dude, if you're on a SEAL team and you're the sniper or the marksman on the team and... Even your teammates are like, we need to make sure this dude can't use his rifle.
There was one individual, I can't remember if I already closed out the article, but there was one, they claimed, he was given immunity, but he came forward. He claimed that because the ISIS fighter was in critical condition, they knew he wasn't going to make it. Mm-hmm. He stated to the jury that he had wound up closing off the airline to the ISIS fighter so that he couldn't breathe, so that he would just pass basically peaceful.
So, okay. That's not as brutal as what the original story was saying, because it was saying he stabbed him while the corpsman was working on him. So, but I don't know. Either way,
it's a lot of he said, she said, still going back and forth right now.
Either way, he was found not guilty, and he's still in the Navy. He's still a SEAL. And, yeah. So, moving right along to the next topic, which was?
The best free PC games out there right now. Okay. This is a very, very long article, ladies and gentlemen. So, I'm going to hit on a few free games that I enjoy. You can look on the link. Find some that you like. You can, again, hit us up, tell us which ones you favor, and we could talk about that another time. Personally, I have three to talk about that I enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
And if Athan has any, you can go talk about them. One of my personal favorites, I got into this about 2 years ago. It's been out for a long time, but they constantly do more updates and stuff. It's America's Army. Mm-hmm. Created by actual Army members and veterans and stuff like that. It's fairly realistic. There's still some jumping that I think is ridiculous. Like, people jumping around corners and pre-firing, which is insane. But it's a very entertaining game. Usually it's 12v12. One group of people's attack, one group of people's defend. push on areas and either get the flag to extract, get a VIP to extract, blow up certain objectives. I mean, there's multiple different gameplays for a free game. It's very entertaining. All you have to do is create an account, log on, and you're ready to roll. They have multiple different classes you can choose from. You can be a sniper. You can be a assault gunner. You can be a designated markman and a heavy gunner. All the while, you have either flashbang smoke grenades or regular frag grenades. And it's just, it's one of the communities that I find that has been less toxic, especially if you find a dedicated server with a active admins, because they keep it very, very controlled, very friendly. And, you know, this is one of those communities. We're not looking for people to come in and just talk shit all day long and bitch and moan and gripe and you're an asshole, you're a bitch. No, we're not looking for that. So that's one of the reasons it has stayed a close favorite game of mine. I go back to it often. But, you know, for a free game, you get what you expect. So, you know, don't expect fancy skins and guns and all this different stuff. So, you know, take it with a grain of salt. A lot of people find it entertaining. As I mentioned earlier, Athan played it once and went 0-23.
Yeah, I did horribly.
So, so it takes a little bit of getting used to, especially if you like Athan going from controller to mouse and keyboard.
Yeah.
The next one that I play, I'm not going to say it's a favorite. It's not even one of my top tens. My roommate loves it. He swears by it. It's called Ring of Elysium. They've done some new map updates. They're constantly changing things. They're another one that do the Rumble Royale passes and stuff like that, that you can earn skins and experience and stuff. It's a huge map. It's anywhere, you're looking anywhere between 32 and I think the highest number I've seen is 60 people. You can play in first or third person, which was new to me when I first started playing the game. I typically only play first person shooters because third person is basically a free way to get a wall hack, because you can look around corners without being around a corner. You've got a zone. It's kind of like PUBG. You know, it's the Rumble Royale, zones closing in, stuff like that. You know, you jump in, you pick up guns, weapons, attachments, armors, and you go to town. There's vehicles scattered around randomly. Currently, they're doing a volcano map. So if you stay out of the area too long, you wind up losing oxygen. One of the new things they did add, which I find very weird, it's fun, but it's weird, is they give you a aquatic vehicle you can use to travel through water, even though there's boats, but they'll put hidden treasures out in the water, and you can dive down with this submersible, go find some weapon attachments, better weapons, but it's one of those things where if you're going to push for it, expect it to be a hot zone.
Yep.
The next and last one I'm going to talk about is Rumble Royale, which is a ridiculous game. It's another Rumble Royale game. It's another huge groups of people trying to survive, be the last ones alive, right? I play it because it is funny.
Yep.
You get different weapons. You can have swords, throwing hammers, throwing axes, guns, sniper rifles, bows, arrows. It's more of like a mythological kind of gameplay. It's not the army style guns. It's not these hardcore, got to get that MP5, got to get that R700, stuff like that. They're really weird, unique weapons. So it's funny to see how they play and react and respond. You get different abilities, like you can glide for a little bit, you can fly, you can jump super far, you can go invisible. But the reason I find it funny is because you've basically got three or four lives, if I remember right. Instead of being able to get picked up, you turn into a chicken when you get shot. And you can run around. As long as you survive as that chicken, you come back to life.
Yep.
You can put, okay, he shot me, I'm down. Book it, hide. But while you're the chicken, you're clucking, you're dancing, you're making a lot of noise, you're giving away all your position. So you've got, one, to be able to play the game and kill people, and two, you've got to be able to know how to hide and get the hell away from people. But I find it funny because I enjoyed watching the chickens run. As far as the free games I liked, that's what I had to offer. Athen, back
for,
to you.
For me, I don't really have very many free games. For me, it would be Realm Royale as well. That's one of them I've got. Yeah, Julia, a chicken. You get turned into a chicken when you die. But yeah, Realm Royale is one of them. Another free game that I play is Paladins, which is kind of an Overwatch-type knockoff game. That one's pretty fun. And as far as I know, those are the only free games I've got that I really actually play. Most of the other free games I've had just kind of sputtered out pretty soon thereafter. And then, you know, obviously Rainbow Six Siege, and then...
But that's not a
free game. They're not free ones. Yeah, I was going to say, they're not free.
We're talking about free games right now.
They're cheap, but they're not free. Yeah, but I mean, yeah, as far as free games, those are the only ones I've got. Does Connor have anything?
I play Smite because it's toxic as shit, but it's fun.
So it's like Rust. Rust is one of the most... Oh, God. I thought Rust was bad.
You can get into like a lobby with somebody before even playing a game and already fucking hate the guts out of somebody.
Oh, God. That's a terrible idea.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, then, let's put everybody in a chat room together and let them start talking. They're going to find who they want to kill real quick.
Yeah,
basically it happens. And then there's a... Fuck it, I play Paladin sometimes, but not much. Mm-hmm. Fucking... I played Realm Royale. I liked it, but I'm not a big fan. But I have played the beta of a new Royale game coming out called Spellbreak.
Spellbreak.
Yeah, basically you're a wizard, mm-hmm. and you use your magical abilities as a... It's a Battle Royale, but using magic. And you can destroy terrain, you can throw fucking like poison fields out. It's a really fun game, and I'm hoping they're going to be like still free when it comes out. But
I'll have to check that out.
You'll have to keep us updated on that one.
Yeah, you have to like sign up for the open beta, and typically it takes a day for them to get back to you, and they typically always accept you into the beta.
Okay.
But if anybody else finds any other free games that you think is entertaining, interesting, whatever, please let us know.
I might actually have a free some beta keys for like a giveaway. Hold on, let me check my emails.
Free what?
Some beta keys for Spellbreak.
Oh, okay.
Spellbreak. Let me check.
So if you do find any other free games
I got two
out there.
I got two keys here.
Sweet.
Who wants a key?
I wouldn't mind one.
I'll check it out.
You had to go on the Epic Games Launcher and you sign it up from there. I'll send it to Afron on Discord, and I'll send it to Cameron on Skype because then time I can get him on.
Okay.
So I think you got a key, and let me just go here and send you one. It was in the Epic Game Store. Just type in that code. You got it.
All right, I'll check it out after the show.
It is really fun.
Okay. Did you say you sent it to me on Discord there?
Yeah.
Connor? I didn't get anything.
Oh, shit. I might have sent it to the wrong person. Hold on. Let me delete that before he claims it. I haven't talked about having a hot minute on here. Holy shit. There we go.
Sweet.
Is that the right code? Hold on. No, that's the one I sent to Cameron. Hold on.
Okay.
Athen, just send that one to me.
Okay.
I'm still chilling in the Discord as well, so...
Oh, he already deleted it, so...
Ah, well.
Hold on, I'll get the right code.
Jesus.
Okay, but to those out there watching right now, again, if you find anything entertaining on the list, please let us know so we can check them out as well.
There you go.
Okay. All right. My phone stopped. All right. So let's go on to the next story. How much longer do we have? Yeah, so these last two stories should be able to take us pretty close to end time. All right, so I know most of us have probably heard everyone's got their panties all up in a bunch again because of Nike dropping the Betsy Ross commemorative tennis shoes that had the Betsy Ross flag on it, and Colin Kaepernick got angry and said it was racist, and Nike stopped producing the shoes. So what happened was Grunt Style went and they made a Betsy Ross Style flag t-shirt in response to that. Obviously, it's a publicity stunt because they know pretty much their entire customer base is going to like that. And, you know, they don't care who's going to say, oh, that's racist. Because when you come down to it, it's really not. But
when they got interviewed, they literally said, and I quote, we did it.
Mm-hmm.
So they did not care. One of my favorite quotes, those who fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it.
Mm-hmm.
The Betsy Ross flag was designed around the 13 original colonies, for those of you that can't remember.
Mm-hmm.
But they're, you know, with all this mayhem coming out about reparations and slave owning and stuff like that, that happened a long time ago, people. Mm-hmm. Nobody owes anybody a damn thing anymore. You get out there and you work it.
Mm-hmm.
I know my first job I had when I was 15, and I'm pretty sure out there there's older people than me that had first jobs when they were 11, 12, before all these child labor laws started coming into place. So I'm not going to pay you a dime out of my pocket. Tax is already taken up. You think you're going to get my money? Mm-mm.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And it's like, with all this, I mean, I'm not going to ban... I don't really like Nike much anyway. Just generally, it's not my type of clothing that I wear. But if you're going to get all up in a bunch, you know, your shit all up in a bunch and start burning clothes and all that crap because you don't like the politics of the company, you're just taking things too far. That's just kind of keeping the ball rolling downhill. It's like, you know, another thing, I don't understand how anyone can sit there and call this racist because it was to commemorate the Betsy Ross flag is what those shoes were for. And, you know, Betsy Ross was a huge proponent for, you know, anti-slavery. She was a big part of the freaking Underground Railroad and all kinds of stuff. You know, that she stood for everything, you know, against racism, which... I don't know, but it's because it's commemorating to them, I guess, the history of America, which, I don't know, that's just a whole bunch of crap that I don't think is right.
If I go too much into this one, I'll get real political because there's laws protecting the flag, there's laws protect, you know, stepping on and burning the flag. There is fines and jail time associated with that. You know, I'll start throwing out, you know, the tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of tyrants and patriots. If I go into this one, I'm going to be here for hours.
Well, let's not do that.
so I'm going to leave it as, you know, Grunt Style, they had the balls, they went and did it. They said, you know, we're proud U.S. vets and we're going to, you know what, we're going to do it.
Well,
I love their shirts. I got plenty of them.
Terrell said in the comments down there, he said he has an Under Armour sweatshirt with Betsy Ross stars around the logo. He said he's had it for like a year. So it's like, you know, Nike wasn't the first company to try to put the Betsy Ross flag on their clothing. And again, it's just if you want to get all huffy about it and start burning your clothes because of that shit, then it's just my opinion is you're part of the problem.
The problem.
It's just
I did find it funny. I read in the article that there are people that are rejecting, it might have been a different article, but people are rejecting Nike entirely, and they're claiming we're going to go back and wear Converse. Ladies and gentlemen, let me remind you who makes Converse right now. Nike.
Yep.
So if you're going to go out and try and be political or patriotic or go against some company for something, you might want to dig a little deeper before you start saying something.
I'm not sure if Julio Spud Romaine is talking about Grunt Style or Nike, but I do know there's a lot of people that have very negative feelings towards Grunt Style. A lot of people really dislike Grunt Style in general, as far as that goes. I guess they're not exactly all for... I don't know exactly what the reason is, but there's a lot of people out there who dislike Grunt Style. I'm not going to jump on the bandwagon just because a bunch of people told me that they don't like them for so-and-so reason. But I don't know. It's I don't. I have a couple of Rumstyle shirts.
Their shirts are comfortable. They fit me well, and I'm a big guy. I'm 6'3", 290, and they have the longer length. They fit the arms better. But, you know, that's like saying I'm not going to listen to this singer because of his political views. You know, if you like something, buy it. You know, don't jump down their throats too hard because of something they've said or done. You know, if you take it that hard, just don't buy their stuff again.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense to destroy a perfectly good pair of boots or shoes or shirts or something for something somebody said. Yeah, you don't like it. You wear it out, and then when it's dead and done, just throw it away.
Exactly. So, but I guess we'll move on to the next story before we get too far into politics. We're already going to do that. Yeah. All right, so.
This is our last topic of the day.
Yep. Last topic that we've got for the day. This one is, hold up, this is another gaming one. So this was 15 years ago, I do believe. A game came out, on PC called, I can't even remember what it's called now. Good Lord.
City of Heroes.
Yeah, City of Heroes. It was a MMO kind of based off, it was like a, supposed to be like a, WoW clone, because it came out after WoW, trying to take WoW's, a little bit of WoW's glory, and they figured the way to do that was with, superheroes. So you go in the game and you design your superhero with your own powers and all that stuff, and then you play an MMO just like, you know, World of Warcraft as a superhero. It went on for quite a while. I think they shut down the servers in 2014, I do believe, is what year it was.
No, the game was launched in 2004. In 2012, NCSoft terminated the developer contract with them. So 2012 was actually when the game went down. However, in 2014, there was a secret server that came out. But because of a non-disclosure agreement, the player that was keeping his server up and running wasn't allowed to inform others about it going on. Well, six years later, it leaked out. It got into, I think they said, a Discord channel, and they said 100,000 fans have already started playing into the game again. There's already multiple servers. I think they said, yep, 9 private servers have started coming back to the community. The studio was concerned about funding, but the fans themselves, it was only going to cost the studio a little over $2,000 to keep the servers up and running. The fans came together, raised over $6,000 to keep the servers continuing. And yep. And originally, the concern with the NDA was that there was going to be legal recourse for leaking the game back out. Mm-hmm. But as it stands, there has been no legal action taken so far. So the servers are still up and running, and the person that leaked the information is still sitting fat, dumb, and happy playing a game he's loved.
Yep, and they said there's like 100,000 players on it, which is, I mean, that's a pretty good-sized community for, you know, a game that you like. You should always be able to find someone to play with at that point. So, had you ever heard of that game, City of Heroes, there, Connor?
No, but I wish I did.
So, I played
a cyberpunk game.
I played a little bit of it. It was actually pretty neat. You know, you were in a city, stuff. So you know, a modern city and all that stuff. And you designed your costume for the hero. You designed, you know, you went and you picked out your different, you know, your different abilities. So, you know, you could make yourself just like any other MMO. You make yourself a healer. You make yourself a tank or a DPS and all that stuff. And you go out and you fight supervillains and crap like that. And I believe, if you remember correctly, because I tried playing this way back when it first came out, so I don't remember 100%, but I'm fairly certain you were able to choose whether you wanted to be a good hero or a villain hero as well.
That's exactly what it was.
DC Universe Online?
It was similar.
Yeah, it basically DC superheroes. You can pick however you want to be a villain, a superhero, and like
but
if you bought like
solely
DLC,
off the DC universe.
Yeah, if you bought DLC, you can like get like the Green Lantern's powers. You get like Wonder Woman's powers,
Superman.
And stuff like that.
It was funny actually reading this article because the fans had claimed they didn't know how to react originally because, well, it's back, but now how do we handle the city? The community originally spiraled into madness because the heroes had wanted to retake the city while the supervillains were responsible for letting everything go hungry and letting it, you know, city run into chaos. Mm-hmm. But shortly afterwards, everything started to turn back into a normal community, turned back into normal gameplay. But they had said that it was such a chaotic dash from the gun that people were confused on how to respond. But now, you know, after only just a few years and months of being out, they're absolutely riveted that it's back and that they can play their game again.
And that's awesome, though. I mean, there's a little bit of good happens every now and then in the world. So, I guess with that, time for us to go ahead and start heading out. Thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you for watching. We love your faces. Remember to tune back same time, same place every week. Except for there might be a week or two here in the near-ish future that I might not be able to do the show. We'll cross that path when we get there. I'll keep everyone updated. Make sure you follow me on Facebook, Athen Daily. You can get to me through the link in the comments. Just click on my name and send me a friend request. I accept all friend requests I get. Unless, you know, it's obviously a fake person, then I'll say no. But, yeah, check me out on Facebook. Check me out on any other social media. I'm on Twitter. I'm on Instagram, which I'm going to be using more often now. I'm on everything. I'm on Snapchat. I'm on Patreon. If it's a social media thing, I'm on it. And look me up. You can always find me with either looking up Athen Daily, It's 1700 somewhere, or L Train Fighters. With that, moving on.
You can also find us streaming some games probably later on and see how we act in some high stress environments and toxic communities that we were talking about.
Some of the toxicity. I think tonight we should probably jump into the streaming games slowly. Maybe we should do some Rocket League. I
think we need to show them America's Army and see how you run through that.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, vote on what you think we should stream tonight below in the comments. We're going to give you, let's say, three options. Rocket League, Rainbow Six Siege, and America's Army.
All right, let's
see. We can show you one of the free games. We can show you two of the games that are on sale under $10 right now on Steam. So post in the comments, and we'll listen to y'all, and hopefully we can make some more laughs happen.
So, not sure if we'll be getting many comments on there, but Connor? We give him a few minutes to be able to answer. Joe Little Spud Romaine says she's heading out. Thank you for watching. Have a good weekend.
It was a pleasure.
So, yeah. With all that, Cameron, do you have any outro type stuff to say?
I'm Cameron Bates. This is Athen Daily. And this has been It's 1700 Somewhere.
Connor, say your goodbye.
Peace out, motherfuckers.
Peace out, motherfuckers. We love y'all faces.
I thought some professionalism.
Nah, you don't get that with me.
All right. Y'all have a wonderful weekend. Keep your dicks dry. No, don't keep them dry. Keep them...
Even wet.
Keep it wet. Gun out of the dirt, whatever. I fucked that all up, so you have a wonderful
one
weekend.
One stink, two in the stink.
Tune in next week. We hope to see you again.
Yes, we most certainly do. Let me get this stopped now.